Say, man, who's that cat coming down the street?
I don't know, but it sounds to me like that whistling man with the bone.
Sure having himself a ball.
Okay, first things first. There was no debate. That's a pretty epic misnomer. What we had was a showcase of Republican grab-ass that was more about pageantry than anything of substance, as evidenced by Herman Cain's alleged win. And if that's not enough for you, look no further than Brett Baer's drivel of a question to Gary Johnson.
Governor Johnson, if you had a reality TV show like Donald Trump does, what would it be?
Wow.
Yeah. Wow is right. I think I would have been less upset had Charles Manson been the one asking the questions with Russell Crowe's shitty band on the musical score. Well, I'm searing inside
your picture. I'm supposed to be your friend. Do you feel blame? Are you mad? Do you feel like Wolf's Bob Refrenich? Get Frenich? Get Frenich? Get Frenich? Get Frenich? Get Frenich? Get
Seriously, though, despite the silly antics and vapid bullshit, I was pretty damn impressed with the Republican candidates. Well, 40% of them anyway. The other guys were a joke. The same old trite talking points responsible for the near extinction of the Republican Party in 2008. Tim Pawlenty was one of three neocons at the debate. A loser and a plastic man, Pawlenty's tepid GOP talking points are hardly worth mentioning. Although you gotta chalk it up to his handling of being exposed as a fake. The Fox curmudgeon panel aired footage of his advocacy for cap and trade, to which he responded with, quote, "I was wrong, it was a mistake, and I am sorry." Now you usually don't hear that kind of candor from a politician, so I'll give him credit. Other than that, the dude is fucking clown shoes. Then you have Santorum. Rick Santorum is a degenerate fraud. His eerily well-kempt and generic appearance is the perfect picture of a jerk-off. And his hackneyed brand of social conservatism is the reason that young people tend toward the left. His authoritarian tendencies really did shine through at a couple of key points during the debate. I literally heard his butt pucker shut at the mention of the word homosexual. And I can only imagine the kind of imperial adventures embarked upon by a guy who advocates sodomy laws, equates women in the workplace to radical feminism, and the guy who said that the right to privacy, quote, "doesn't exist, in my opinion, in the U.S. Constitution," end quote. The man is a nightmare. Nuff said. Then there's Herman Cain. I have to admit, I like this guy. His strategic rhetoric and rich milk chocolate voice could sell me my own fingernails. But lest we forget, Cain is a shill for the status quo. He chaired the Kansas City branch of the Federal Reserve and openly denies the need to audit the system responsible for a crumbling economy. And I'm sorry, but just because you spearhead a couple of pizzerias doesn't qualify you to helm a crumbling empire. The fact is, Herman Cain deals in charm and empty platitudes, which is why he won the polls. Fortunately, the spectacle consisted of more than demagogues, closet cases, and harlequins of war. There arose recently a distinct schism in the Republican Party between GW-style warhawks, in concert with Bible Belt conservatives, and a rising libertarian movement working in tandem with certain factions of the Tea Party for the end goal of fiscal sanity. Gary Johnson, a participant in the, quote, debate, falls in the latter class. Despite his whining tantrum and the fact that listening to him speak is about as exciting as watching flies fuck, he is more qualified for the Oval Office than any of the other contenders, including Ron Paul. Johnson is the ex-governor of New Mexico, who was term-limited as a Republican in a 2-to-1 Democratic state because they liked him so much. Among other things, he balanced a soaring budget deficit and left office with a $1 billion surplus. He lowered taxes, busted ass to legalize weed, and vetoed over 750 bills, which is more than the other 49 governors at the time vetoed, combined. Besides that, he started a one-man home maintenance operation and built it up to be one of the biggest construction companies in New Mexico, with over 1,000 employees. Then, the motherfucker climbed Mount Everest with a broken leg. Basically, the guy is a hero and a shoo-in, except for the fact that he has a hard time forming words, and that he can't win, especially with his pro-choice stance. Now, I happen to agree, but the thing is, a huge block of his would-be supporters are pro-war, pro-death penalty, and yet pro-life types. Ironic, huh? Disingenuous turds, if you ask me, but I don't make the rules. Worst of all, Gary Johnson will siphon needed votes away from Ron Paul in the primaries. Gary, you're an inspiration. Now drop out. If you're lucky, you'll be Paul's VP, save America, and run for president again in 2016. And this brings us to the final participant. An advocate of peace, champion of liberty, an iconoclast of the American right.
Congressman Ron Paul of Texas, who is currently serving his 12th term in Congress.
A lot of folks consider you the founding father of the Tea Party movement.
You say that the federal government should stay out of people's personal habits. You say marijuana, cocaine, even heroin should be legal if states want to permit it. You feel the same about prostitution and gay marriage.
You were asked, should gays be allowed to marry? You said, quote, sure, they can do whatever they want and call it whatever they want. Are you advocating legalizing gay marriage in this country?
I think the government should just be out of it. I think it should be done by the church or private contract, and we shouldn't have this argument. Who's married and who isn't married? I have my standards, but I shouldn't have to impose my standards on others. Others have standards, and they have no right to impose their marriage standards on me.
Are you suggesting that heroin and prostitution are an exercise of liberty?
Yes, you have a right to do things that are very controversial. If not, you're going to end up with government that's going to tell us what we can eat and drink and whatever. We don't have a First Amendment so that we can talk about the weather. We have the First Amendment so we can say very controversial things. If you have the inconsistency, then you're really not defending liberty.
Well, you say that we should cut off all foreign aid to the Middle East and, quote, let them take care of themselves.
I think they become too dependent on us, not only for money, and they economically become dependent. They become dependent in that they can't even work toward peace with a country that we might not like them to do it. If we stop all the foreign aid, you say, oh, you're going to hurt Israel. But, you know, the Arab and the Muslim nations get twice as much money. So I think Israel should be in charge of their sovereignty, and we should never intrude on what they do. And if they want to attack Iran, we shouldn't tell them what to do or what not to do.
You have wanted to pull U.S. troops out of Afghanistan for years. In fact, you said on the House floor about the U.S. military's efforts in Afghanistan, quote, whose interests do we serve by continuing this exercise in futility?
Boy, it is a wonderful time for this country now to reassess it and get the troops out of Afghanistan and end that war that hasn't helped us and hasn't helped anybody in the Middle East.
To hold the applause.
I think secret military prisons, keeping people there for years and years without due process, is not a characteristic of a republic that believes in freedom. It's more typical of an authoritarian government to have secret prisons. Since we should treat people the way we think we might be treated under dire circumstances.
You routinely vote against raising the debt limit, and you want to cut government spending, you say, by 50%, eliminating everything from the Federal Reserve to the Department of Homeland Security.
Yeah,
under your plan, what would you leave for the federal government to do?
Yeah, I'd sort of like to follow the Constitution, and then we wouldn't have these kind of problems.
I never thought heroin would get applause here in South Carolina.
So who do I support for president in 2012? That's right, Barack Obama.
What?
I said Barack Obama.
What?
Don't ask what, ask why.
What?
Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you, motherfucker. Say what one more goddamn time.
What?
Look, this isn't a joke. But then again, it's not entirely serious either. See, here's where I need your feedback on what I'm about to say. And one more caveat. There are a lot of variables at play, so really it's all up in the air. Here it goes. Here's my thesis statement. In the long run, it is likely that a 2012 victory for Barack Obama is a victory for the cause of liberty. So far, America has not yet hit the crisis, pending as a result of parasitic government activity. Government spending has spiked the debt to dangerous levels, while central planning, taxation, and ignorant regulation has caused the outsourcing and dismantling of the American productive capacity. Crisis is imminent, and I believe, nearing its ultimate manifestation. Obviously, the only way to rebound is to shrink government and grow the private economy. But it's a catch-22, because cutting government by the necessary amount will only cause the facade to crumble that much faster. Anybody seen at the helm while that's happening, and therefore their corollary ideas, will be perceived by the masses as the root of the problem. I have no doubt that someone like Ron Paul would do exactly what we sent him there to do, which will expedite the necessary liquidation, or, in layman's terms, bring about the greatest depression. Once again, freedom will be scapegoated as the cause, and the people will clamor for a Leviathan, forever tainted in their conceptions of liberty and socialism. To be clear, all of this assumes that default or rapid economic deterioration occurs after the 2012 election. There are a lot of ifs, and for the record, I will vote for Ron Paul. On the other hand, if during a second term, crisis occurs on Obama's watch, the opposition, and more importantly what they represent, will be there to clean up the mess and facilitate the restructuring. In other words, let statism leave the taste of squalor and adversity in the mouth of the public mind, not liberty. Because the ideas of a generation eclipse in power the force of any law or the weight of any election cycle.
I am all alone in this world and I have no one to go to.
What?
I said, sometimes I feel like I'm all alone in this world and I have no one, sir.
What?
No one.
What?
To go to.
Huh?
No one that understands my pain.
Yeah!
Yeah!
Sometimes when I'm alone, I sit on my hand. Wait till it gets numb and masturbate. I call that a stranger. Have you ever given yourself a stranger?